let's start out by playing around with the function and seeing where some of this vocab comes from. So we had this function, pretty simple function. Okay, seen a function like that before? Seen an equation like that before? Yeah, so maybe without realizing it, you were using a function, or maybe you heard that word before and you knew you were using a function. Okay? So how do I use this function? What does it do? Can't do a whole lot, right, Sean?
Plug in something for x and it'll show you y.
That's all it is. That's as simple as it gets. And what he just gave some example of was the input and the output, right? And now as far as input and output, your basic understanding of what input might mean and what output might mean, you pretty much got it. Like some of these other vocab words, they have a little bit more detail to them, but that's pretty much it. If you think of input as something going in and output as something coming out, you got it. Okay? So input is something that goes in, output is something that comes out. So somebody give me an example of, well, let's list some inputs here. Okay, let's just make a list of inputs. What's an input that can go into this function? Cadence?
Like pretty much anything, like zero.
Okay. Yeah, we'll just start with some specific examples, and we'll list some outputs. So for that input, what output would you get?
3.
An output of 3. Okay, let's give a few more examples of input, Sean.
1. 1,
five. And what do we get? We get a 5. Okay, anybody else? Any other input? Anybody new? Don't be shy. Johnny?
2.
2 seven. Gives you?
7.
7. Alex?
3.
3 gives you, what's that?
9.
Gives you 9. 3 times 2 is 6, 3 is 9. Alright, so we've gotten some examples of inputs and outputs. Right? Might take more, but we'll try to catch up here. So lists of inputs and outputs. Now, the list of inputs, however long you might make that list, or short you might make that list of inputs has got a name. Its name is the domain. Okay, so under that domain, that word domain, you might put list of inputs. All possible inputs. The things you can put into a function. Now sometimes with the domain, you may just have a specific domain. Okay, for some reason we've chosen this to be our domain. Are there other numbers that can go into this function?
Yes.
Yes, but for us right now, in this specific example, this is the domain because of the inputs that we used. Okay. We might make a different list of inputs, like all the possible inputs. Okay, that's a list that we could make. But for now, this is a specific list of 4 inputs. This list of 4 inputs is the domain. So we want to look at their list of vocab words and make a guess as to what this list might be called.
Range,
exactly. So what might we put as the definition of the word range on our paper here? List of outputs. I'm not going to write it, it's very tiny. I actually had to make this bigger so that I could write these words and shrink it down. I can't write that small. Okay, so list of outputs. List of inputs. List of outputs. Did you say outputs?
No.
Okay. Blanked out or something. So, yeah, domain and range, list of inputs, list of outputs. Okay. So far, so good. Now, I want to take this time to point out exactly what makes a function a function, and then I'll show you something that's not a function that you might think is a function, because it does what I think a function should do, right? So, a function, we've seen it, we've been watching it work so far, we've been putting things in and getting things out, all right? And that's part 1 of 2 of a definition of a function, okay? So part 1 is you put things in, you get things out, all right? So if under function, if I wanted to start writing a definition, I'd put part 1, Roman numeral 1, input and output. You might want to use a few more words than that, or may not want to use more words than that. But if you put something into the function, you get something out of the function. It's a pretty simple thing. The one other thing that the wording of it may trip you up even for a little while, but I want you to write this wording exactly. Each input has exactly, that word exactly is important, one output. Pretty short, doesn't sound very complicated. But I want you to show you, I want to try and show you what I mean by showing you how this function is a function. It does that part two of what a function is supposed to do, and then we'll look at another thing that looks like a function. Looks like it is input and output all the same way, but it's not exactly a function. So each input has exactly one output. Let's look at this input, zero. How many outputs does it have? What is that output?
Three.
Are there any other outputs when you put zero in there?
No.
You also get seven.
No.
You also get -3. Do you put zero in there and somehow like it just doesn't compute? It just doesn't work? It doesn't lock up the function or confuse the function in any way, right? And that's because it's a pretty simple function. It wouldn't get confused. There's no problem. All right. So every input has one output, not just one output, but exactly one output. Not zero and not two, but one. Certainly have three or four or five outputs. All right. Starting to make sense, you think? But you might be thinking, like, well, I mean, what could not do that? What kind of function would not have exactly one output? Okay, so let's look at this supposed function. We don't have to dwell on this for very long, but just a quick example of a thing that, you know, it's got y, it's got an equals, it's got an x, it's got some math stuff involved. You would think that it's a function. Okay? But let's look at an input, well, let's just call that input x, I guess, just for time's sake. All right, so I'm going to put into this function a 4. So who can tell me where to come out of this function if I put in a 4? Cadence?
2.
You're saying, which one are you saying?
Never mind.
You're saying 2? Okay, 2. All right, so if Cadence is right, then, you know, I should put into this function, excuse me, an equal sign there, right? Into the function is a 4, square root of 4, is the square root of 4 2?
Yeah.
Square root of 4 is 2. Why is the square root of 4 2?
It's 2 times 2.
Okay, so the square root of 4 equals 2 because these three dots mean because 2 times 2 equals 4. Because 2 times itself equals 4. So if I could put a number here that would also complete this statement, well, I mean, it would be the square root of 2, wouldn't it? If a number can multiply by itself and give you 4. Is there another number that can multiply by itself and give you 4? No other number? How about negative 2? Okay, needs to multiply by itself. So, if I had a negative 2 times another negative 2, would it give me 4?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So it seems like negative 2 is the square root of 4.
But it's not exactly.
What do you mean not exactly?
Each input has exactly 1.
Oh, right. It doesn't have exactly 1 output. So 4 has an output of 2, but 4 also can have an output of negative 2.
Does that mean negative 2 is not an output, or is it non-function?
It means this is not a function.
Okay.
It violates part 2. Now we can mess with it a bit. And we'll say, well, let's let this be a function. For it to be a function, it has to not do this thing that it's doing by giving us two outputs. Let's just like accept only one of those outputs. Let's take the positive output and ignore the negative output. Okay? That's called restricting the range, right? We're putting restrictions, limitations on the range. What is the range?
The
outputs. We're saying, ooh, let's fix the output so that we have a function and no longer a non-function. Okay. Just a quick note, if it looks like a function, but it doesn't act like a function because it violates that second part, we call it a relation. So that's the word for a function that's not really a function. Kind of misbehave. A misbehaving function is a relation. There is a relation between the 4 and the 2, and the 4 and the negative 2. But since we get two outputs for the same input, well, that's not a function. Not a function, it's just called a relation. Okay. So function, every input has exactly one output. Alright, we got the input idea, we got the output idea, the domain, got the range. So then we have the independent and the dependent variable, right?
You guys heard that before? That comes up a lot in science classes. You guys have some science classes where you talk about independent, dependent variables?
Yeah?
Okay.
Let's see. So if I go to the gas station and I go to put gas in my car, so I go to put gas in the gas tank. Right? Now, how far can I drive on this gas? Well, could we say that it depends, right? See that word depends? What does it depend on?
How much gas?
There you go. So we got independent and dependent variables. Where how much gas I put in doesn't really depend on anything. I mean, it kind of depends on me. But the relationship between the gas and the distance I can travel, the distance definitely relies on the gas, right? Does that make sense?
Yes.
How far I can drive depends on how much gas I put in. It all depends on how you phrase the relationship. I'm going to put some gas in, I want to know how far I can drive. Well, it depends on how far I can drive. It depends on how much gas I put in. So in this case, gas is which variable? Independent or dependent?
Independent.
It's just kind of free to be whatever it wants. It could just be 5 gallons or 2 gallons or 3 gallons. It doesn't matter because it's totally independent. Okay? Independent. Distance, what's the distance?
Dependent.
Well, we could rephrase this a little bit. Now we could say, okay, we put some gas in there, put, I don't know, 10 gallons of gas or whatever. Now I'll ask this question, rather than saying how far can I drive, I'll say how much gas will I use once I leave the gas station? Depends. Now the gas depends on something. How much gas I use depends on something. What does it depend on? How much driving I do. Like, it kind of comes just down to, with all things considered, stopping and going, how far I drive. So now, the gas, how much gas do I use? It depends. It's dependent on the distance, how far I drive. Now the distance is
independent.
Okay. So it's not always the same. It's not always just like universal gas is always the independent and distance is always the dependent. It depends on how you phrase the question. See what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Depends on how you phrase the question. So the distance now is independent because it decides how much gas you're going to use. But here, how far can I drive is going to depend on how much gas I have to use. So how the question is phrased is how you can decide which is dependent and which is independent. And you can work out your own little tricks on figuring it out, but if one thing is kind of in charge and it decides what the other thing can be, then that's the independent one. The one that depends on the other one, that needs the other one in order to change, that's the dependent variable. So, and a vending, so you go to the vending machine, can someone name for me in a vending machine what an independent variable might be? Okay.
How much money you insert into the vending machine?
machine.
So how much money you put into the machine, and which variable is that, dependent or independent?
Independent.
Independent, right? So it's free to be whatever amount you. So if like Cadence is named, the amount of money you put in to be the independent variable, then what is the dependent variable?
Yeah. Candy you get.
Yeah, the candy you get, or how
whatever.
Much candy you get, right? The things that come out, right? There's their input output too. Input change and some numbers, and outcomes something, candy bar, chips or something. All right. Now let's talk about this function y equals 2/5 x plus 3. Okay. And let's talk about the domain. Remember, what's the domain? The meaning of the domain? All of the list of all the inputs. Okay. List of all the inputs that I use, or the list of inputs that I could use. Right. So let's just go all out. Let's just name all of the inputs that could be used in this function. Yeah.
Five.
All right. Let's see when we get tired of this. Five. Yeah.
Ten.
Okay. Keep in mind, it's not just the inputs I want to use, but inputs that could possibly be used, that are like allowed to be used. Anything?
Yeah.
Even not multiples of five?
Yeah.
Like could one?
That would be the easiest.
Yes, these would be the easiest, but are the other ones impossible? No, they're impossible. They're just not as easy. 1, 2, 3, 4, all those are okay. We can do them.
Yep.
They can compute. 1/2?
Yep.
0.734297? All of them. All of the numbers can be used. Okay? All of the numbers. Now, if we were going to be really mathematical, which we will be, we would say they're all the real numbers.
What would be a not real number?
Yeah, not a real number. Okay, so it would be, I just actually learned. There are lots of not real numbers. So you got the real numbers, and you got not real numbers, which actually contain the real numbers. It's just a little bit bigger. And then there's a set of numbers that contains those numbers, and there's a set of numbers that contains those numbers. And this keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger. But I guess the one set above real numbers would be called the complex numbers, which include these numbers called imaginary numbers, which is why we call them, why these are called real. The most basic imaginary number is this guy. Can somebody tell me why that seems like a big deal? It's just the square root, just a negative number, yeah?
There's no square root to negative 1.
Why not?
Because it's itself. Yeah, 1 can.
I don't know. Well, you can't really get negative if you square root something.
Yeah, so to get negative 1, you have to have something like negative 1 times 1. That's almost like a square root, but negative 1 times positive 1 is not the same as taking the square root. It's not that's not how you square a number. So it can't be equal to 1, because clearly 1 times 1 is not negative 1. You might think, well, maybe negative 1, but even negative 1 times negative 1 is positive 1. So this number is still a number. That when you multiply this number by itself, what you get is negative 1. Which, with the real numbers, is possible. With imaginary numbers, you can do it.
Is there infinite imaginary numbers?
There are infinite imaginary numbers. Because you combine the imaginary numbers with the, because here's the this is like the imaginary 1.
Yeah.
Right? And so I could have two of these. I could say 2 times the square root of negative 1, and that's another imaginary number.
Okay.
So this is the basis of the imaginary numbers, just like the number 1 is the basis of the real numbers. So, just to answer that question, you know, whenever I write the word real numbers here, I get the question, what's a not real number? So that's what that is. It's at least one example of a not real number. So anything can go in there, all real numbers can go in there, but we can't put that square root of negative 1 in there, it wouldn't compute. So non-real numbers don't go in there. All real numbers, though, are allowed. What about the range? What things can we get out of this function?
Negative
Johnny?
All rulers.
What do you guys think? It's easy enough to put whatever decimal you want, but could you get out whatever decimal you want? I mean, put just find the right, just the right input. You get the output that you want, right? Cadence?
Yeah.
So you're just agreeing?
Yeah.
All real numbers. Just to prove it, let's look at the graph. And the graph will convince you that the output, the range is also all real numbers, okay? So this has a y-intercept of 3 and a slope of 2/5. We're going to go up 2 to the right 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay. When you look at the equation, you could say, yeah, I could put any number in for x. Sure, it might be messy, but I could get it. Or I could plug it in, whatever I want. If I draw the graph, remember the graph? What's the graph made of?
Infinite numbers.
An infinite number of points, right? Each point represents a pair of numbers, x and y. Okay, now look at this line. Okay? And you can see the inputs, right, all along here. Is there, like, imagine any x that you want, like 0.7. Okay, 0.7 somewhere around here. Is there a point that goes along with x is 0.7?
Yeah.
Yes.
That's right there, right? And it has some output. What about a million? Is there a point that goes along with a million?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just way, way up there. And negatives as well, right? So every x value has a point that goes with it. What about the y values? Does every y value have a point that goes with it?
Yes.
It goes infinitely down, right? Kind of slowly. It's kind of got a shallow slope. But if I go far enough out this way, I can have the line go down as far as I want, down to negative a trillion, if I really wanted to. Right? And what about 0.3? I'm sorry, the y of 0.3. Is there a point that goes along with the y of 0.3?
Yes.
It's right over here. There it is. There's a point. Right? So there's some x that goes along with that y of 0.3. So that y is possible. All y's are possible. So the range, right, the list of all the outputs, y being the typical output. Yes, all real numbers. Okay. Let's look at a different function. Just to be, how about next to your input and output, like in parentheses next to input, in the parentheses next to input, just put like x, just the variable x, right? Because x is usually your input, usually. 95% of the time, maybe. Maybe there's 5% of the time that it's not x. The only time it wouldn't be x is because somebody decided to call it something else. Okay. And next to the output, you can just put in parentheses y. Y is usually the output when we're talking about a function. Okay. And let's look at this function. This is a function. Okay. So y equals x squared. And when we have y equals, y equals, like the variable that's by itself, that's, we could also tell, like, that's the output, the one that's by itself. If this is y equals, that's going to be your output. If this is x equals, oddly enough, x will be your output. Okay. But y equals is the typical way to write it. So, y equals x squared. What kind of numbers can I put in for x?
All real
numbers. Anything? Positive numbers. Fractions, decimals, negative numbers, everything. All the numbers. So the domain, again, is a list of all the inputs. There's actually a symbol that I can use to mean all real numbers, so I don't have to take all the time to write all three of those words.
Infinite.
No? Infinite is like not very specific. Does that mean also imaginary? I don't know. So all real numbers means, or this symbol means all real numbers. It's an R for real. It's just got two of these vertical lines. What do you call them exactly? All real numbers. All right. How about the range? What could the, what can the output be? What is the range of this function? What's that?
All real numbers.
All real numbers? Question mark. Is it all real numbers?
Mm-hmm.
Seems like it. I mean, I get, I take 1 and I square it, right? I put in 1 to this function, what do I get out? 1. I put in 2, what do I get out?
4.
If I put in negative 3, what do I get out?
Negative
9. 9 or negative
9?
9.
Put in negative 4, what do I get out?
8.
Positive 16, right, times itself, that times 2. Cadence?
No. Well, if you put in a negative 2,
yep.
Then you get 4.
Yep.
And if you put in 2, you get 4.
Okay.
So it's not a function?
Okay, we'll talk about that. It's a separate issue. And it's a good point that you bring up. But the range itself, does it seem like there's anything about the range that's a little bit unique about this? Manga?
A positive
number? Positive. Can you get a negative number out of this function?
No.
You square a number and get a negative. No, you know, Grady brought it up earlier. You can't really square a number and get a negative number. So, just the positives, and we're also, by saying just the positives, we're missing one number.
Zero.
It's not positive. Not negative, it's zero. So we could say all the real numbers that are positive, okay, are with a little positive kind of in the exponent spot, and zero, there we go, that's the range of this function. We could also say the range is why is any number that's greater than or equal to zero. That's just the second way to say the same thing. You could say it in words, y can be any positive number or zero. Just write out all those words, and that would be a way that you can tell me what the range is. Now, to what Cadence brought up, x, if x is negative 2, you get 4, and if x is 2, you get 4. Does that violate the function definition?
Yep.
Okay, that's why I wanted to do that. So I said it could trip you up, and it's tripping you up. Let's read the definition. Somebody read exactly the definition that they have for part 2 of a function.
Each input has exactly one output.
Each input has exactly one output. Let's look at each of these inputs and test them. This input, how many outputs does it have?
One.
Does it have exactly one?
Yeah.
Does it have another one?
No.
No, it doesn't have, it's not like it's positive and negative 4. How about this input, 2? We input 2, what do we get out?
4.
And only 4.
Yeah.
So two inputs can share an output, but
yeah,
they can have the same output. That doesn't violate what we wrote down earlier. Every input does have one output. Okay. If we go back to that non-function, the square root of x, okay, we see how the inputs, there's two inputs that are the same, right? And this input has two different outputs. The other way around, we have no problem. It's a perfectly functioning function. I put something in, and the function knows exactly what it's supposed to do. It gives me exactly the right output. And there's no confusion there. All right. With the square root one, it's like, well, which one do you want? You want 4 or you want negative 4? You want 2 or negative 2? There's multiple outputs that can give you. So, that pretty much has it. And make sure. So we're able to catch up a little bit and get one more year at the end of it all. Here we go.
Is it just 5.1?
Yep, just that 5.1. I guess that should say.
Yesterday night, so it should be done.